Okay, good afternoon. Welcome to all. I'm really glad to introduce and honored to introduce the speaker of today's colloquium, Alessio Figalli, and I'm grateful to him to have accepted our invitation. It would not be needed to introduce him much because most of you know him, but let me say a few words about him. He got his doctorate, PhD, in 2007 under the supervision both of Luigi Ambrosio from Scuola Normale of Pisa, okay, and of Cédric Villani from Ecole Normale Supérieure of Paris. And after his PhD, he became charge of the research at NCRS in France. And then he got his position at the Ecole Polytechnique as Professor Adamar in 2009. Then in 2008, and then in 2009, he moved to University of Texas Austin, where he remained until 2013, when he moved to Zurich. 16, sorry. When he moved to ETH in Zurich, where he's now. So, okay, although his young age is already many awards and recognition, so let me just mention a few of them. The EMS Prize in 2012, the Picot-Vimont Prize and Cor Picot of Collège de France 2011 and 12. The Stampacchia Gold Medal in 2015, and more recently, last year, the prestigious Feltrinelli Prize in Mathematics 2017. Okay, Alessio has worked in many different areas of analysis, calculus variations, and PDEs that goes from optimal transportation to Monge-Ampère equation, functional and geometric inequalities, elliptic PDEs, Hamilton-Jacobi equation, transport equation with rough coefficients, so on. Okay, let me just stop here. Let me just finish saying that he was invited speaker at ECM, European Congress of Mathematics, in Krakow in 2012, and at the International Congress of Mathematics in Seoul 2014. I am really pleased to be giving the word, and he's going to speak about the regularity of interface in phase transition the obstacle problem.
Okay, so thank you. I'm not supposed to give it in English or in Italian?
No, just English.
Okay. Well, first of all, let me say that it's a pleasure for me to be back in Padova. Last time was almost 10 years ago, so it has been a while. So thank you for inviting me to give this colloquio a Patavina. So today I would like to discuss some results about regularity of interface in phase transitions. So my, let's say, my starting point is the so-called Stefan problem. So the Stefan problem actually hasn't been introduced by Stefan. It hasn't been introduced by Lamé and Clapeyron in 1831. And the goal is to describe essentially the phenomenon of phase transition that you get when, for instance, the ice melt into water. So just picture of ice melting into water. So essentially the setting you have is the following. So let's say I have my domain. Here I draw a cylinder. And I have the ice and the water. I impose some boundary condition, let's say some temperature on the boundary of the domain. And I have the so-called here free boundary. So the free boundary represents the interface between the water and the ice. And our goal is to understand how this free boundary looks like. What can we say about the interface between these two media? So in the Stefan, you have to describe the evolution of this problem. So what is the evolution of this problem? I'm going to consider that there are many Stefan problems. There are many models. But there is the most classical one, which is the one I'm going to use, is the following. So I have a function theta, depending on time and position, that tells me the temperature at some given point at time t. Then I'm going to assume that the temperature in the ice is identically zero. Okay, so this is like kind of a simplification. And then, of course, the temperature of the water is greater than zero. That's Okay. And then temperature changes in time. There is as time passes by, temperature change, and the way temperature evolves in time is through the so-called heat equation. So it's a very simple evolution equation that happens in the water. So there is the temperature of each point is influenced by the temperature around it, and it kind of adjusts to satisfy this parabolic equation. So there is an evolution equation describing the evolution of the water. And so essentially, these four conditions are telling you what is theta inside, is zero, and they're telling you how theta evolves in the water. But still, you need an extra condition to say how the water and the ice interact. So you need to impose a condition on the interface. And this is the so-called Stefan condition. And the Stefan condition is the following one. So if you take a particle on the interface, this particle is going to move in time following a simple ODE, x dot equal minus the gradient of theta at the point itself. So if you draw theta in one dimension, you get something like this. So let's say this is theta equals zero. Now here theta is positive, so this is inside the water. So you compute the derivative of theta here, the gradient at this point. You see that the gradient is gonna point outside, so minus the gradient is gonna point inside. And so what happens is that the phase theta equals zero will shrink as time evolves. Okay, so this is the problem, and the main goal is to understand the evolution of this interface. Now, there is a useful change of variables that are gonna bring us from phase transitions to obstacle problems. And so this is called Duvo transformation. Essentially what you do is that you take simply the temperature and you take the integral of temperature in time. So you can think of this as a mathematical trick. Actually, this U as an interpretation, but I don't want to enter into that. So you just integrate, and then you look at the function U, and you try to find an equation for U now, using the equation for theta. And there is a little computation. I won't do it. But what you can notice is, first of all, OK, theta was non-negative. So of course, the integral of theta is still non-negative. And the time derivative of U is theta, so because and so also the time derivative of u is non-negative. So u is a non-negative function, which has non-negative time derivative, which means that it's increasing in time. And the equation you can find is the following. Actually, there is this. Maybe let me move the pointer. Yeah, better. There is the following equation, which tells you, let's say here you have your domain, u equals zero, here u is positive. And okay, where u is zero, you don't say anything, but where u is positive, what you're saying is that dtu minus Laplacian u, so the heat equation, is equal to minus the characteristic of u positive. So the characteristic of u positive is the function which is one in this domain and zero outside. So this is 1 where u is positive, so it's minus 1. Okay? So that's the equation. So you have a function u, which is 0, and outside it satisfies now this equation with an extra term minus 1. And then there are some boundary conditions. And now in this case, there is no transmission anymore here to be prescribed because everything is hidden in this, this is a bit maybe more technical, but everything is hidden in that formulation. So I'm telling you more than just here in this formulation, I'm telling you more than this, because I'm telling not only that this is equal to minus 1 here, and that dtu minus Laplacian u is 0 inside, but I'm telling you that the equation is satisfied everywhere with this right-hand side. So it's this must be true everywhere. And in some sense, it's telling you also what your function is doing here. I'm writing the equation at every point in a weak sense. But let's say this is slightly more technical. But anyhow, we have an equation now. And why is this an obstacle problem? So I'm going to explain this in the next slide. But So what is the goal? We have now this evolution, and we want to understand what can we say about you, and what can we say about this interface, the boundary of U positive. So this interface between the positive and zero set. Okay, so why obstacle problem? So to understand this, I'm gonna actually simplify the problem, and I'm gonna assume that we work in a stationary setting. So I remove the time. Let's remove one variable, at least things will be easier. So I remove this, and I look at the elliptic case, the stationary case where there is no evolution. Okay. So to simplify the presentation, I'm gonna focus on the stationary case, and my problem becomes the following now. Just the same as before, without time. So I have a function u now, depending only on x. And I know that the Laplacian of u, right? So Laplacian of u, which is the sum over I of dii of u, sum of pure second derivatives, is equal to this characteristic, and u is non-negative. Okay, why this is an obstacle problem? Because there is another interpretation of this equation different from the one I gave it before from Stefan, and is the following. So suppose that you take an elastic membrane, okay? You give me, let's say, a wire. You hold the wire with your hands, and you put an elastic membrane, let's say, attached to this wire. And there is gravity acting on the wire, so let's say your elastic membrane under the force of gravity will bend a bit. And so you will get some shape. So if you take an elastic membrane, let's say, that is held at these two sides, the elastic membrane will do something like this. Now, suppose that there is a plane here that blocks everything. So if you start to move down this wire, so I'm holding the wire and then I start to move it down, there will be a moment where my elastic membrane is gonna touch the table. Okay, so as I move down, this goes down, and then there is a moment where I will touch. So if these are the boundary condition where I'm holding the membrane, and the membrane will touch and it will stick on the table on some domain. Okay, so if you write the equation for this elastic membrane, the equation satisfied by this membrane, is actually exactly this. Because these are the stationarity condition for, let's say, this energy. So for people who are familiar with that, I will not. But let's say if you minimize this problem, so you look at all functions, so this is so the grad v square represents the elastic energy of the membrane, and the v represents the potential energy. And so if you minimize this problem with the constraint that v is non-negative, which means that V cannot cross the table, you find that the minimizer will satisfy this equation. So that's why it's an obstacle problem, because you are thinking of a membrane which must lie above an obstacle. And the question is, when you take this membrane and you let it touch the table, what can I say about the contact set? Okay? Okay, so first question, as I mentioned before, is the regularity of the solution. So we are interested in understanding the regularity of U. Okay, so this is, let's say, a classical problem that has already been understood in the 70s. And the main properties are the following. So the first thing you can prove is that U is C11. So what does it mean, C11? So UC11 means that u is twice differentiable, and the second derivative of u are bounded. And so we'll not prove this, but you can easily see that this is kind of optimal, because what will be the next step? So if you want, think about without derivatives. I tell you a function is bounded. Okay, next step will be the function is continuous. Next step in regularity. I mean, after bounded, there is continuous. So here I'm telling you, okay, the Hessian is bounded, good. But the next step, if I wanted to prove more, would be try to prove that the Hessian is continuous. But the Hessian cannot be continuous, because I told you that the equation that we have here is minus Laplace and U equal minus 1? So maybe let me rewrite it without all these minuses. So our equation is Laplace and U equal 1 here in the positive set, and U equal 0 here. So where U is 0, the Laplacian, which is the sum of the second derivatives, will also be 0. So the Laplacian is 0 here, but is 1 here. So it means that the sum of the second derivatives jumps. So if the sum jumps, in particular, the Hessian has to be discontinuous. So there is a jump in the second derivative. So d square u is not a continuous function. So the best I can hope to prove is that it's bounded, and that's true. So this is the optimal regularity. Next, we can try to understand how, so if you take a point here on the free boundary, I can ask myself, how is u behaving nearby this point? So you can take a small ball around the point on the interface, and you try to understand the shape of u. And what it all, so u will be 0 at this point, because it's on the boundary of u equals 0. And what happens is that you can is that the sup of u over the ball of radius r grows like r squared. So the picture is something like this. And this is usually what you should have in mind. So u near a boundary point is, let's say, behaves as 0, of course, on the contact set here. But where it detaches, it looks like a parabola, x squared. And so in a distance r, it grows like r squared. Okay, so this is the kind of picture we have in mind. And with this kind of idea in our mind, we want to now understand the regularity of the interface. Because really, so in some sense, this slide tells you everything you need to know about the regularity of u. But then now the main question is, what can we say about this set? Okay? Okay, very well. So how can you study it? Okay, so how can we study the regularity of this set? So there is a standard technique in actually is a technique which is used a lot in geometric measure theory. So probably you have seen something, I don't know if he mentioned something, Camillo Dell'Ellis, in his talk, when you try to study regularity of minimal surfaces. But in general, there is a very classical technique when you want to understand, let's say, fine properties of geometric objects. And the technique is called blow-up. So what is the blow-up technique? The idea is that, so I want to understand how this interface looks like. So I'm gonna take a very small radius and rescale everything at scale 1. So I'm gonna zoom my picture, and I'm gonna take now a sequence as r goes to 0 and try to get, so I take this ball, I zoom, and I make this ball 1. Then I do it with a different ball, and I still rescale to 1. And I keep looking what I see in a ball of radius 1. And then I try to let r to goes to 0 and to find kind of an infinitesimal picture of my interface around that point. So the way you do it is something like this. So to rescale the picture, so I have to zoom in this ball and make it a ball of radius 1. But I also need, so here I have u. I need to find a new function here. I have to rescale also the function with the problem. And the way I rescale it is by this way. So I translate u by x0. So x0 here becomes the origin here. And then I change variable. So u x0 plus rx. So I delete the variable by r. And then I divide by r square, because I know that, since I know that u equals like r squared in a ball of radius r, I want to get something of order 1. So you see, here I have a ball of radius r centered at x0. I zoom. Now I have a ball of radius 1. My function u becomes this new function. And because u was like r squared here, this function u x0 r is going to be like sides 1 here, because I divided by r squared. So the r squared simplifies. So you see, this new function now is 0 at the origin, because u was 0 at x0. And the sup of this function, the ball of radius 1, is order 1. So I have something non-trivial. And so now the idea is that I would like to let r goes to zero and find a limit and try to get maybe something out of this limit. If you want to get a limit as r goes to zero, you need some compactness. So you need to prove that the family of this family of functions is compact in some topology. And usually the best way to find compactness is some Ascoli-Arzelà theorem. You need some equicontinuity. How can I get it? Well, I'm going to use the optimal regularity, this Hessian bounded. Because since the Hessian is bounded, what happens with the Hessian of this function? So if you compute the Hessian of so if I compute the Hessian of ux0r at x, when you differentiate with respect to x, every time you differentiate, there is an r coming out of the derivative. And so the r's simplify, so they are, you differentiate twice, so you get r squared, which simplifies with r squared at the denominator, and this is the same as the Hessian of u at x0 plus rx. And in particular, we know that this Hessian is bounded, so this Hessian is bounded. So this means that I have a family of functions which are all defined in B1, they are zero at the origin, size one, and their Hessian is uniformly bounded. And then if you use Taylor expansion, you just prove that the Hessian is bounded, implies the gradient is bounded and as well, and therefore these are uniformly continuous. So they're compact. So there exists a limit as r goes to zero. And so you just take all the possible limits, you look at the set of limits, which, and these are called blow-ups, the set of possible limits, and then you ask yourself, can I characterize these limits? Because if I can characterize them, what I'm telling you is what is the infinitesimal behavior of u around a free boundary point, and if I can characterize, then maybe I'm able to extract informations around for you in a small neighborhood. So these blow-ups are just really looking at the behavior infinitesimally as r goes to zero. But maybe by that behavior I can extract then something back. Okay, so characterization of blow-ups, so that's the goal. And now I'm gonna give you two definitions. What do you expect as blow-ups? There are, you will see there are two natural candidates for blow-ups. One possible is what is the case of regular points. The case of regular points is the following. So you do a blow-up, and what you see in the limit is something like the following. 1 half e dot x positive part square, where e is some direction. So the picture is the following. You have the free boundary, you have your boundary that looks like this. Then your function looks like this. Is zero here, and then it grows like a parabola. And then you start to zoom around this point. And in the limit, you're gonna find something which is zero on the left, and 1/2 e dot x square on the right. Right, so it's just a function of one variable. Depends only on the direction e. So the candidate, I mean, up to change of variable is 1/2 x1 positive part square. And that's a very natural candidate for a free boundary, right? So this is a we call it a regular point because this is what we expect to see if our domain u equals zero was nice and smooth. We will always expect to see that. However, if you think a little, maybe there are points which are not of this kind, and these are called singular points. And the singular points are the one for which whenever you take a limit, you get a quadratic polynomial. So A is a matrix, and you get 1/2 AXX, where A is a non-negative definite, and it has trace one. So the trace one comes from the fact that the Laplacian of U is equal to one when U is positive. So because of that, that's how the trace one condition comes. And the kind of picture you should have in mind is the following. Maybe your free boundary point is this. So here in this case, you see u is positive here and is zero here. So your function looks something like this now. And if you start to zoom around this point, in the limit you're gonna get just 1/2 e dot x square. So in this case, 1/2 x1 square, without positive part. So a quadratic polynomial. So at least this is what you expect to see in dimension 1, in dimension 2, sorry. Because, well, in dimension 2, there are not many matrices which have trace 1 and are non-negative definite. Essentially, the only possible ones are this. But of course, as the dimension increase, the space of these matrices gets much, much larger, and there are many more cases to handle. And this will be important for later. So what do we expect to see in dimension 3? In dimension 3, for instance, you could think of this case. So the contact set is what is drawn there, that's x0. So essentially, this is just the same as in the previous slide, just where I added a fake dimension. So you just take the 2D picture like this as a contact set, and you add a third dimension. You multiply, and then you get something like this. So in this case, let's say the direction here maybe is E2 in my picture, and the polynomial is 1/2 x2 squared. So it's a polynomial which vanishes. See, if we're in dimension 3, this polynomial vanishes for x2 equals 0, so on a two-dimensional plane. But another case could be the following. You could have that maybe the polynomial is 1/4 s1 squared plus x2 squared. This has, you satisfy the same conditions, non-negative definite, trace 1. And in this case, you see the zero set of this polynomial, it's a line. It's the line along the E3 axis. So as you take the limit, you will get a function which is positive outside and is zero on the line. Okay. And so, okay, here I just gave definitions. I gave you the definition of regular point, I gave you the definition of singular point. Now we need a theorem, putting things together. Okay, so the definition is the so-called, there is a very famous theorem by Luis Caffarelli, proved in 1977. What Caffarelli proved is that if you give me a free boundary point, then one of these two alternatives hold. Either a point is regular or a point is singular. So the definition really makes sense. And more precisely, if it's regular, actually the boundary of u positive in a small neighborhood of this point is analytic. It's a nice analytic surface. So it means that it's super nice. It's really an hypersurface, super smooth, wonderful. Everything is clear. So it's really the picture you have in mind. It's really this. There is a nice surface. And then on the left here, u is 0. And on the right, u is positive. So there is a really a separation between u positive and u negative. But what if 0 is singular? If 0 is singular, what you can say is that the free boundary, the boundary of the u positive, is contained in a, so ER is some direction on the sphere, and is contained in a small strip of width little over. So again, the picture is like, this is a regular point, and this is a singular point, and you see that around a singular point, the free boundary gets thinner and thinner. It's trapped in smaller and smaller strips. Okay, but now the theorem of Caffarelli, so in the first case, it's kind of conclusive. It tells you everything you want to know. It's a nice analytic surface. But the second one is not conclusive very much, because it's not telling me anything really about the singular points, just that they're trapped. But first of all, it doesn't tell me whether, so ER here would be this vector. So you are telling me that the singular point is trapped. So you have a ball of reduced R. And let's say there is a direction ER, and the free boundary is trapped, let's say here. And this is little over. But a priori, in this theorem, you see this direction ER may depend on the radius, which means that at this, in this scale, I see a picture like this, but maybe if I zoom much, much more, and I look at the picture at this scale, maybe at this scale, I see something completely different. Maybe the ER is oriented in a different way. So this theorem doesn't prevent that the free boundary kind of tilt and oscillates. So at this scale is oriented like this, but when you zoom, in fact, the picture is maybe rotating, and then the free boundary is oriented like this, and then you take another radius much smaller, and then the free boundary is oriented 90 degrees more, and so on. Maybe, for instance, it could rotate. You can easily build up counterexample called something like logarithmic spiral. You could have a logarithmic spiral that turns around to the origin, and for the logarithmic spiral, you will get a phenomenon like this. It's trapped, but as you keep changing the radius, the orientation changes. So Lewis' theorem doesn't prevent this. Lewis Caffarelli's theorem doesn't prevent. And in addition, this little of r is not in quantitative. It's just little of r. We don't know how fast it is. And it comes from some compactness argument. Okay, so this is a problem, but this was solved actually 20 years later. So I'm gonna define sigma, the set of singular points. And the set of singular points in the free boundary. And then Caffarelli in 77, then Sakai 91, Caffarelli-Rivière, sorry, in 77, then Sakai in 91, and then they proved this theorem in dimension 2, and then Caffarelli in 98 proved the general theorem. So what they proved is that this limit, as u goes to 0, to p star, so the polynomial, so a singular point, remember the definition. Singular point is, u is a singular point if up to a subsequence of radii, you converge this. So the limit here may depend on the sequence of radii. Okay, what they proved in 98, what Lewis proved in 98, is that this is really a limit. So the limit does not depend on the radii along which you look at. In addition, it's telling you something more. It's telling you that this polynomial that you get, which is telling you the behavior of u around that point, depends continuously on the point. So if you take a singular point, x0, and another singular point, x1, the two polynomials you get are gonna be not too far if the points are close, okay? And then as a consequence of this, actually Lewis could prove a structure theorem for the singular point. Now, this requires a little more definition because you will see in a second by more pictures, you cannot treat all the singular points at the same way. Well, in fact, you can see this even before. I mean, morally, this singular point should be different from this singular point. It really, because this looks like a one-dimensional picture, this looks more like a two-dimensional picture. So you need to distinguish between the different dimensions that you can see when you blow up your free boundary. So there could be multiple dimensions appearing. And so you just give a definition that allows you to look at different dimensions. You just say, okay, let me define, for every point x0, let me define kappa x0 here, the dimension of the kernel, the dimension of the set where p star is 0. So I look at the dimension of the 0 set for the blow up. And then, given m, I define sigma m as the set of points, the set of singular points for which this dimension is m. So I just took the set of singular points and I stratified it according to this definition. So to give an example, look at this case. So in this case, the polynomial was vanishing on a line. So it would be at this point x0, kappa is 1. So x0 is in sigma 1. For this point, the polynomial was vanishing on a plane, and so sigma 2. So this is the dimension on the set on which the polynomial is vanishing. Okay, and then, so what you will have more in general is something like this. This could be the 0 set of u. So we are in dimension 3 in this picture. You see, u could vanish at some isolated points. These are gonna be part of sigma zero. They are zero dimensional. It could vanish maybe on a line, sigma one. It could vanish on some plane, sigma two. And then these points are regular. This is the fixed set. And so if you see this picture, what you expect to say is to say that sigma zero is zero dimensional. sigma 1 should be one dimensional, and sigma 2 should be two dimensional. That's what the picture suggests. And this is what Caffarelli proved as a direct corollary of the previous theorem. For each m, sigma m is contained in a C1 m-dimensional manifold. So locally, you can always cover your singular points by C1 m-dimensional objects. So I have a small sketch of proof of this. I will be quick, and then maybe if you have more questions, but I just thought it was nice to give this sketch because it's really quick and it gives some flavor. So what is the idea of the proof? So the main difficulty is the previous theorem, the one I stated, the fact that these polynomials are unique and they depend continuously on the point. But if you accept it, what I'm telling you, so by telling you that, let me go back maybe, by telling you that ux0 plus rx over a square converge to this polynomial, it's equivalent to say that I have an expansion like this. That u at x0 plus y is this polynomial plus little of y squared. And now if you look at this, this is nothing else than a second order Taylor expansion of u around the point x0. So if I have this, this polynomial is nothing but is representing the Hessian of u. So this polynomial represents the Hessian of u at that point, at least formally. If you have a nice function, that's what it is. And now by saying that my polynomial depends continuously on the point, I'm telling you that this matrix depends continuously on the point, which means that the Hessian is continuous on the singular points. But if I have a function for which the Hessian is continuous, formally, this doesn't make sense mathematically because I'm telling so, but formally it means that the gradient is C1. This doesn't make sense because I'm telling you that a function is C1 on some closed set. You cannot define C1 regularity on closed sets. You need open sets. But so here there is a trick. But if you accept that, then you go on a second, and you realize two things. You realize that the gradient vanishes on sigma m, and you realize that sigma m is defined in this way, in such a way the dimension of the kernel of the gradient, which is the Hessian, is equal to m. Now, just believe it for a second, but the point is that once you have these two, you have a C1 function, which vanishes on a set, and the dimension of the kernel of the gradient of this function is m, then you can apply implicit function theorem, which tells you that the level set of this function will be contained in a C1 m-dimensional manifold. So even if you didn't follow the details, it was more to give a flavor of how you get these kind of results. There is an implicit function theorem. And the key point of this proof is that you see, C2 regularity of u gave me C1 regularity of the singular points. So you lose one derivative. So whatever regularity you get on u at this level, you get one regularity less at this level. So actually, you could prove this more in general. So in a sense, if you can prove that u minus the polynomial s is smaller than r squared times some omega of r, some of continuity, you can actually get some C1 omega at the level here. So the point is that usually, so if here, for instance, you put r to the alpha, so you get C2 alpha, then here you get C1 alpha. So you always lose one derivative. If here you put C3, here you get C2. That's the philosophy.
Now, I went fast just because, I mean, essentially what I already told you. It's not essential. I don't want to, it's slightly more technical, but. Okay, so the key point is this. Whatever regularity I prove on u, I get one less on the structure of the singular points. And this is kind of the idea behind our goal. So what is our goal now? So Caffarelli proved this theorem, very nice. Can we improve it? Can we prove better than C1? So this has been a question which has been around for a while, and actually it was improved already 1 year after Lewis by Weiss. Weiss discovered some very powerful monotonicity formula. I will not enter into that. And then here I just put some words which are more for the experts, but the key point is that Weiss proved the following. In dimension 2, you can prove R to the 2 plus alpha for some alpha. So Caffarelli had little over square, here you have a power. And because of this, sigma 1 is contained as sigma 1 alpha curve. So he got the improvement on the singular points in dimension 2. Now, what about higher dimension? So Weiss developed a whole machinery in his paper that, I mean, it had nothing to do really with 2 dimension. Just there was a very last moment in the proof where he couldn't do anything if the dimension was 3 and higher. He said, I don't know how to use it. I mean, only in dimension 2 it works to conclude this, to get this power. Then 18 years have passed until last year, Colombo, Spoller, and Velichkov, they wrote a paper using this method, and they realized that in dimension 3 and higher, you could still make this proof work, but a price to pay. Here, you cannot put a power, you can only put a negative power of log. So it's still something going to zero, but very, very slowly. Okay? And in particular, this means that you have a C1 log continuity. So you are C1, and the modus continuity is logarithmic. And so you could say, okay, maybe they didn't get the right way to prove it. Then, after this, so this came last summer. In the meantime, myself and a postdoc of mine, Joachim Serra, were working actually on the same problem. And by a completely different approach, we've proved this theorem. So first of all, the C1 alpha regularity of Weiss here, for some alpha, in fact, is you can prove C2. So the curve is actually better than C1 alpha. More important, what happens in dimension n? In dimension n, you actually need to distinguish between different points. So I will try to give you an idea. So let me draw maybe the picture again, the one I gave you before. The contact set could be this, then maybe there is something two-dimensional, and then whatever, something else. So here is this is sigma 2, and this is sigma 1. And then there is sigma 0 here, but okay, these are isolated points, so there is not much to say on sigma 0. Let's try to understand sigma 1 and sigma 2. Okay, so in this picture, there are going to be 2 statements for sigma 1 and for sigma 2. Sorry, for sigma 2 and for sigma 1. And in general, in every dimension, there's going to be 2 different statements depending whether this number is m minus 1, so is the largest one, or if is below. So first you look at the largest one of all the strata. So you look at sigma m minus 1. So sigma m minus 1 can be split in 2 pieces. The points sigma m minus 1 g, that you can think is g for good, or g for generic. I thought it for generic, but also good. And then there are the A points, because A stands for anomalous, because we couldn't call it singular, and then singular points were not so nice. So we call them anomalous. So there are the generic point and anomalous points. For the generic points, you can prove C11. So you improve from C1 to C11, the regularity. And what about the anomalous points? The anomalous points are small. The anomalous points have codimension 3. So there may be some bad points, but at least they're much smaller than the generic points. And if you want a full theorem, a theorem that tells you, okay, but what happens when I put them together, you get C1 alpha always in every dimension, for some alpha, depending on the dimension. Okay, so you have an hypersurface, which is globally C1 alpha, and if you remove a very small set, this guy, then you actually improve to C11. What about the rest? For if m is less or equal to m minus 2, you have the same splitting, generic anomalous. On the generic part, you still get C11. The anomalous points now have are dimension m minus 1. So they have codimension 1 inside this. You have an m dimension, m minus 1 dimension. And what can you say about the union? Again, C1 log. C1 log. So we don't get C1 log because we copied them. I mean, we get C1 log because we gave a different proof, and we get C1 log again. So in their case, Colombo, Spolar, and Verichkov, they got C1 log here and here, everywhere, on the union. In fact, we get C1 log only here. And then we get a bound on these, and provided you remove these, you can improve to C1-1. Okay, and then, of course, there are a few, this is okay, a minor comment. Whenever this number is zero, dimension zero, I mean discrete set. So discrete, finitely, I mean, locally, you have just points. Okay, now, so how do we prove this kind of theorem? To prove this theorem, you want to prove C11, and as I told you, C11 at this level means one power more for U. So you need to prove something like this, which is actually what you will prove for smooth functions. So if you get a, if you give me a smooth function and you subtract the Taylor expansion up to order 2, the next steps will be something of order power 3. That's what you expect for smooth function, to get a cubic next rest. So it's not so absurd that you can prove this. Okay, we get consequences, like for instance, we can prove that this is like a nice older cusp, we can bound this, the shape much better. But so the kind of result we prove, first of all, it improves Weiss. So it goes from, Weiss was, in two dimension was given C1 alpha, we can get C2. And also it extends to every dimension now on the highest stratum. And we recover Colombo's, Polar, and Velichkov. But so, okay, you look at this result, it's kind of confusing in many aspects. You have to split in anomalous and generic, and then you have this log there, which is very annoying. Doesn't look very optimal. And this dimension, I mean, this splitting, when you look at it, you're not very satisfied at the beginning. I mean, at least I wasn't satisfied. I always thought for many, many months that we proved this. I thought for very long I was convinced that we should prove this theorem for the whole set. We should really prove, okay, this set is C11. I mean, what is this? What are these anomalous points? Why do they exist? But then when you went to the proof, there was a moment where the proof was just not working. And sometimes if the proof doesn't work, you just say, okay, what can I prove? Can I prove something at least? Can I make something out of it? And after struggling many months, the only thing we could prove was this. We had, okay, we cannot make the proof work, but we can make it work up to a bad set. Provided we remove a bit set, we can make it work. Okay, maybe still is much better than what was known, so we can be happy. But I don't know, maybe it's just that we are not good enough. So you see the result says, okay, in two dimension you have a C1 curve, C2 curve. In three dimension, sigma 1 will be a C11 curve up to these anomalous points that in three dimension would be just isolated singularities, these anomalous points. And then in 3D, for instance, again, sigma 2 will be sigma 1, again up to isolated singularities. And this global is C1 alpha. So, for instance, in 3D, anomalous points have dimension 0, so they're just points. And so you could think, okay, maybe I have a picture like this, and then there are these anomalous points here around, which are there, and they don't allow me to prove the result I want. So, do they exist? And then, so this we proved this theorem around September. Like, okay, that's still good. And then in November we realized, oh yes, they exist. So it's not that we're not good; they really exist. Okay, we were happy about that. I mean, in some sense, still the theorem is not what you want, but there is nothing you can do about it at least. So in three dimension, we can find solutions where anomalous points exist. In fact, the thing is this. In 2D, if you give me the contact set, so what do you expect in two dimension? In two dimension, when you have a cusp, you expect something like this. You expect your cusp, let's say, to be some nice, so you'd say you have a contact set, You expect that your cusp is made of two pieces of curves, like this, and the, each piece of the curve is a smooth curve. So, see, it's a singular point, but really each guy here should be very smooth. And then in three dimension, you could think the same. You could think, okay, in 3D, I should get just this picture rotated around. So it should still be a very smooth curve rotating. In fact, if you look at the, if you try to solve this problem in three variables, and you study what happens, you can prove, so you get exactly this picture, contact set, plane of symmetry. You look at the shape of this, so you, you see this is an axisymmetric picture, so it only depends on two variables, the radial variable and the z variable. Well, the shape is a function f, which is C1, but not C1 alpha for every alpha. So you can, here, the cusp is never gonna be C1 alpha. And I think that if you play a bit better with our example, with our proof, you can prove C1 log. So the C1 log that Colombo, Spoller, Verichkov found with the epiperimetric is actually optimal. It's not their fault. The proof cannot give you better than log. And the same was for us. That points exist. They exist from dimension 3 on. And the bound that, so we got here, the dimension of the singular points was m minus 1, it's optimal. In every dimension, you can construct an example where you get equality here. So, I mean, we were happy when we got this, when we proved this fact. So here there is a non-trivial proof. So in some sense, you have to, you take this example, you know that it exists. That's not difficult to prove that it exists. But then the non-trivial part is to prove that if you look at this picture and you know that you solve the PDE, so Laplacian equal 1 outside and 0 inside, then really the shape cannot be more than C1. So I had a sketch of the proof, but probably I will skip that. So there is this kind of idea of the proof. I kept it in case I had time, but I don't think it's... okay. Now, so what about the parabolic case? So this is the elliptic. What about in the parabolic? The first natural thing you could try to do in the parabolic is to say, okay, for every time I look at the solution, I look at the regular points and singular points in the, my free boundary, and then I try to prove the same theorem for every t. Okay, in fact, you can do better. Instead of looking at the singular point, so, okay, regular points are gonna be analytic. The problem is what can you say about singular points? You can do better because instead of looking at the singular point for each time, you can look at the union over all times of the singular points, which is a much larger set a priori. And on that set, you can prove the following theorem. That in a sense, whatever I said before for the singular points extend to this union. So this is a, this set can be stratified as a n minus one dimensional set, n minus two, n minus three, and then each piece is composed of generic point and anomalous points, and blah, 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 C11, some piece, C1 alpha, something else, all together. So whatever you write is written in the elliptic case, essentially extend to the parabolic case, but on the union. This is actually nice because it allows us to prove something on the, let's say, smoothness of solution. So you have this evolution of, so what is the problem? Remember the original problem. You had ice melting into water, okay? So maybe you could think, okay, I have my ice. Let's say that my block of ice looks like this. And then it's melting. So as the ice melts, so this will get thinner and thinner, and then there is a moment where these two fronts will touch here, the two points. So imagine that it's like a 3D picture. So the two, the moment there will be this. You will have only a point, and then these two blocks will detach. And you will have something like maybe here. Okay, so then you say, okay, you see, if there this is a singular point, and after this singular point has happened, these two blocks detach, and now here I don't have singular points. And now, but of course, okay, the picture can be much more complicated. There could be a lot of blocks around. And now the question is, how often can this happen? How often can I see singular points? Okay, what we prove is that, so if you take the Stefan problem dimension 3, and then the free boundary is analytic in space-time, up to a closed set of times, so ST is the set of times for which you see singular points, and this set of time has dimension less or equal than 2/3. So it means that it's a closed set of zero Lebesgue measure, actually it's much smaller, it has dimension less than 1, and outside this closed set, you have an open set of full measure, and this open set of full measure, you always see only regular points, which means that your boundary is really smooth. And that's all I wanted to say, so I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Alessio. Oh, it's really a pleasure to follow this voyage in this quite interesting problem. So please, there are questions, comments.
So the problem you're studying is substantially is linear with an obstacle, because the equation is linear, right? So can you?
It's not linear.
Hmm? It's just Laplacian U plus
equal characteristic.
Yes, but that's because of the obstacle.
Right.
But away from the obstacle, everything is linear.
Yeah, Laplacian U equal 1.
So what if I don't know if anybody has thought about doing something similar, but with some nonlinear equation, like minimal surfaces with an obstacle.
Yeah. So okay. So Luca's question would be, let's say. So what you're asking, like u equals 0 here, and instead of having Laplacian u equal 1, I could replace this maybe by divergence of grad u something equal 1. Yeah, or any nonlinear. No. So this makes sense. People have studied it. And I mean, in general, if you take a minimal surface, the point is that once so the only difficulty at this level, all the difficulty is preliminary in the sense that you need to prove simum regularity. But once you prove of solutions around these points, but the point is that once you prove simum one on, let's say, an equation like this, then you can linearize the equation and essentially it becomes back the Laplacian around these points. So let's say the real difficulty is not for equations like this. The real difficulty if you give me a fully nonlinear equation of the Hessian. So that's, sorry for the, but here is difficult. I mean, it's more delicate because you lose everything because there are many monotonicity formulas that are used in this problem. And of course, there are no monotonicity formula for an anisotropic problem. But the minimal surface, it works because when you linear, if the gradient, at this point, the gradient is zero. And then you say, okay, here really, at these points, there is no gradient, so you forget this, and then you're back to Laplacian. But this is a difficult problem. There is almost nothing known on the free boundary here, if you change the Laplacian with some really nonlinear operator, some function of the Hessian, which is not the trace. Yeah. Yes?
What if the nonlinearity has some particular structure, for example, convexity? I'm thinking a situation coming from stochastic control, for example.
You mean, but still fully nonlinear?
Fully nonlinear, but we
doesn't change. Yeah, no,
convexity
doesn't
change. Does not improve.
No,
for
it's
example.
Not concavity or convexity. Ah. I mean, it's not a matter of interior regularity. It's a matter of, I mean, okay, if you have convexity, you can prove simum regularity of solutions. Mm. So you can get the same optimal regularity as for the Laplacian. The problem is at the free boundary level. There is no obvious way to prove that the real difficulty comes from, I mean, you can prove that every blob is convex. No, I don't think that's what I wanted. One second, okay. Okay, let's try to go back. Maybe it's faster in this way. Yeah. okay, let's say more or less you can do this blow up and prove three regular singular points. Essentially this part is still okay. The real difficulty, so you can prove that essentially either you blow up to a singular point or you blow up to a regular point. And you have, so essentially you can arrive here without the Laplacian. But then here you're stuck. You don't know that the limit is unique. I mean, proving that the limit of is unique, it's in general a very complicated problem. It's the same, maybe, I don't know if Camillo mentioned, but the in minimal surfaces, you take blow-ups of minimal surfaces, you want to prove that the blow-up is flat, and this blow-up is unique. And in general, you need something to do that. It's not just a soft argument. And the Laplacian has a lot of structure that you completely lose when you look for free nonlinear operator. So that's the moment where everything breaks down from at this theorem. So it's an open problem.
Okay. If there are no other comments or questions, let me thank you again, Alessio.
Thank you.
And as usual, we are all invited to the refreshment on the 7th floor.